Thank you very much. Yeah, and obviously I like films. So yeah, as I said, my name is Holger. I'm organizer of the PHP User Group, and I also organized the PHP Developer Days, which happened a month ago in Dresden. And I also heard the rumors that the PHP CE will be in Dresden next year. So I'm going to be a co-organizer of the PHP CE next year. And I hope we will have a very great event, like here in Prague, next year. So this talk is about CQRS and event sourcing. And it's very loud. Yes, so let's just start. What is CQRS? CQRS is an acronym for Command Query Responsibility Segregation, which is a lot of words, so I will stick with the acronym if it is okay for you. CQRS evolved from CQS, which is an object implementation pattern, and it was first stated by Bertrand Meyer in the 1990s when he was working on the Eiffel programming language. And it just says, it describes a semantic implementation pattern that says, okay, queries need to return something, but do not change the observable state of an object. And commands should change the state of an object, but do not return anything. So here's a bad example. Yeah, obviously we are changing the state and returning something in the same method. The good example would be this. We have a command method increment and a get number, which is the query. So we have separated this. So Bertrand Meyer described this for objects. CQRS is an architecture pattern, which was first described by Greg Young in his CQRS documents, and very late in 2010. And it just says one part of the application is responsible to change the state, and the other part is responsible to represent the current state of the application. Command and queries have a more broader meaning here. So it's not just on methods on objects. It's more, yeah, commands are objects, or yeah, you could even have a more broader meaning here. So the key concept is to divide your application into a write and a read side, and giving each side an appropriate storage. So his intention was to find a solution to not be dependent on one slow storage, but to be to have the opportunity to change the storage on each side and optimize each side for its purpose. So what is an application? We are PHP developers, I hope so, and we are writing web applications. So a typical web application looks like this, has three layers, sorry. We have a request handling layer, we have a business logic layer, and some kind of persistence layer. And we say, okay, the request handling layer, that knows HTTP, so the protocol and the web. The business logic, of course, knows the business rules, and the persistence layer knows the database. So the good news is you can apply CQRS to all of them. My clicker is too fast. Yeah, so you can apply it to all of them. And after we applied it, it will basically look like this. So we have on the left side the part of the application that is responsible for changing the state. So we will get write requests, we will have our business logic, and we have our state. And on the right side, we will have our read requests, a small part of view logic, and a representation. So the question is, how do we get from the left side to the right side? Given that our PHP applications are shared nothing, so every request is a complete execution of the application, we are not able to have a running state somewhere, like we have a Java backend or something. So We basically need to do this to get from one side to the other. Just do a simple redirect, and maybe we will need the session. And to update our representation, we just use a simple publish-subscribe pattern. So we will, after a state change, we will publish a message, and the representation will subscribe to it, so it can get updated. You can also do this update asynchronously if you have multiple representations of the same state. Then you need some kind of message broker in the middle, and you need to be aware of that this will lead to eventual consistency. So if you do some asynchronous stuff for the representation, it might be that the user will not see the current state of the application. Just to mention it, I wrote a small library called PHP Fast CGI Client, which is able to use the PHP FBM server to do some asynchronous calls, and it's a very good application to update representations in the background. So let's talk about the storage. Usually when you have a legacy application that is not implementing CQRS, you will have a storage in the background. Most of them are maybe MySQL or something like that, or PostgreSQL or whatever. But in most cases, it will be a relational database. And when you start splitting your application, you can do that by layer by layer. So you can start in the request handling layer, then you can go on with the business logic layer, and in the end with the persistence layer. And let's say we have MySQL, it was our database, we have an application that is a couple of years old, we have a lot of data in there. It doesn't make sense to change your write side persistence layer, because having a lot of data in a huge database, migrating to a different technology, this might not be the easiest task. So what is more easy is to change the technology on the read side, because the read side, of course, should be fast. And there you have a decoupling through this message system, this publish and subscribe, that you are easily able to create a new representation with a new data storage and use the new data storage to gain more speed out of your application. So for example, you can remove the MySQL here and replace it with Redis, or even simpler with simple HTML documents. So representing the current state of the application should happen in the most easiest way that you can think of. So when we read an application state in a web environment, we will display HTML code at the end. So, and when your state didn't change, because read request shouldn't change anything, so it's the simple solution, just display in plain old HTML page. That's the simple solution for that. So I will give you an example. I'm working in a company, we are doing e-commerce for the fashion industry, mainly. And we are sending out a lot of newsletters. Everybody loves newsletters, especially developers. That's why I choose the example of newsletters, newsletter subscriptions here, for this talk. So we are a fashion company, and we want you to subscribe to our newsletter, and we present you a newsletter form on our website. You just have to fill in your full name and your email address. So given this newsletter form, this is a simple GET request. We have no view logic, it's just an HTML page. And when we hit submit, it triggers a POST request, of course. So if we look back at our model, we will be here. So we have a POST request to the right side. Because I have given the wrong email address, we won't get to the business logic. The request handling layer will validate it and will say, okay, your email address is not valid. We'll produce some errors. we'll store these errors in the session, and we'll do a redirect to the read request. And the read request is, again, the subscription form. So this is what we get after the redirect. Now we will check for errors in the session. We will render those errors into the form. And the good thing is that we can only submit the form again if we hit the submit button. That is a nice side effect of those redirects, that you have a GET request now. And even if you reload the page, you just get the page again, but you don't submit the form again. So, when we want to change the state, we need to submit again. So, the thing about those read requests is we can have one after a redirect. As I said, you can reload as much as you want. You will always get the same page in the same state. And that absolutely makes sense because, for example, in our industry, most of our fashion online shops have a read-write request separation of 5% to 95%. So most of our requests that we get on our online shops are read requests because we have the users are browsing and looking at galleries and looking at products. And until they decide to order something and, or subscribe to a newsletter, of course. So we have a little part that is doing really state-changing actions. And the most part of the website is just reading. So it absolutely makes sense to optimize the read side instead of the write side. Yeah. So make the read side as fast as possible. So how does that look in code? So this is a typical middleware. I hope you can read it. Can you read it? Yeah? Okay. So this is the middleware to validate the user request. We just check the user input. If it fails, we add some errors to the session and do a redirect. So this is the important part here. And this is the middleware on the GET request side. So we just say, okay, give me a page from a template with some errors from the session. And that's my response. Thank you very much. So my clicker is too fast today. After I corrected my email address and submitted a form again, I successfully initialized a subscription. And we'll be presented a thank you page that will look like this. So, hey, thank you very much, da-da-da. Again, this is a GET request. We have no view logic. This is a static HTML page. And this can be deleted after the subscription has finished. So usually, we are doing double opt-in because we have to. So my subscription didn't end here. I have to do some more actions now. So this is the middleware that applies after my validation has passed, so after the first middleware are shown. And here are two important things. In this part, we are entering our business logic. We are creating a command here that is called init subscription command. And we pass the full name and the email address as value objects, and we send this command to the command handler. After we've done so, we produce a message, which we will send to the message broker and say, okay, I have done something, I've changed the application state because I added a new subscription. So basically it was all we have done so far, covered the left side of our model here. So we did a complete write request, business logic, state change, and we published a message to the broker. So how does this command look like? It's just a simple data transfer object. So we have two value objects in it and two getters for it. The command handler is also very easy. in this case, so of course I don't have any business logic in here. I just take the values out of the command, create a new subscription ID, and add it to a repository in my storage. And that's basically it. Important here is you see those big try catch, and we are catching everything here. So the command handler should be responsible to always return a valid result. Even if the result says it's not successful, but you should always get a result object out of the command handler. So you don't need to handle any exceptions in your request handling layer. So yeah, this is the result object. It just says, okay, am I successful or not? And you would add all those information that need to be passed by the result into it. So the error message is mandatory, of course, even if it's empty. And here the subscription is the optional part. So we can say, okay, if it is successful, I will have a subscription. If it was not successful, I will have an error message. Very easy. And then we have two subscribers to our message that we have sent before. The first subscriber just creates this static HTML page for the thank you that we have seen before. So we are just rendering, again, a template with some data. The data is, in this case, the subscription itself. And we just store it under a unique path. and that is basically the target of the redirect that we have seen before. So, and the second one is the subscriber that sends out the email to the subscriber. Yeah, basically the same. We are creating an email from a template, and so on, and so on. So now we are getting this email. And that looks like this. So you have a button like, hey, confirm now that you have subscribed here. And that leads to a problem. You have a call to action here that you need to change the state of the application. The problem is you don't have the option to send post request out of an email. Yeah, okay, if you have a web client, it maybe works, but from a desktop client, it doesn't work. So in this case, I urge you to respect the HTTP verbs. Come on here, what's going on? Yeah, this is a quote from the RFC of the HTTP protocol. GET and HEAD shouldn't do anything other than retrieval. So they are ought to be safe and yeah, read only. So what we can do now is when we hit the button confirm now, we can just display another website and ask the user some more questions, because now we have him. Yeah, he initialized the subscription, we already have his data. And we can ask some more questions like, what t-shirts do you like? What are you interested in? And how often do you want to have the newsletter, for example? The advantage is that we have a GET request, and we have another form that we can send a POST request from. So, yeah, after we send this up, we will get a finish page, so everything is done now. Now let's have a look at the database. So as I said, we have a MySQL database on the left side. How would that look like? So the first one is my record. I just said, okay, I subscribed here. I only want to have the newsletter when PHP Central Europe happens. And I confirmed the subscription by email, and I also already unsubscribed. So, and I see three entries for my interests. What I want to have, some hipster jeans, some nerd caps, and meme shirts. And the question now is, what happens if I subscribe again, only for meme shirts, and I want to have the newsletter weekly instead of my previous interval? So then it would look like this, right? So I subscribed again, I confirmed it again, I didn't unsubscribe, my interval is weekly, and I have only one topic as a relation. Works, right? So who thinks that is a good solution? Hands up. Nobody. Okay. So your business data analyst would look like this when you see this solution, because we have lost a lot of valuable information during that process. What have we lost? So we actually lost all the information about the first subscription. So we lost the information that I had a complete different interval, complete different interests. The only thing that we didn't lose was the email and the full name. So that is the data that is still there. What else have we lost? I'm just doing this way. Sorry for that. So yeah, we lost analyzable data about how the user decided, oh, I don't want a description anymore, I have other interests now, and also the decision that he reactivated the description. So this is all information that is lost. So we can guess that we had this information. Maybe we have some log files somewhere where we can look up those information. But I think it's not a feasible approach to gather those information and to work with those information, especially. So the problem with those kind of applications is that the state of the application is only observable at the current time. And you don't know what happens, how the application looked like yesterday or will look like tomorrow. And that is where event sourcing comes into play, AKA giving your application a memory. Event sourcing was stated by Martin Fowler and also already mentioned in the CQRS documents by Greg Young. But the pattern itself is was already used in accounting software years ago. So it's not a new concept. They just brought up the name event sourcing a couple of years ago. So the main approach is to record all changes of the state into a sequence of events. Let's have a look how we can install this event sourcing here. So if we have already CQRS applied, that is a very good prerequisite, and you need this prerequisite to install event sourcing. They always say you can do CQRS without event sourcing, but you cannot do event sourcing without CQRS, and you will see why. So basically, the thing is, the important part is this publish subscribe thing. And we have a change with the business logic and the state. So what we are doing now when we're doing event sourcing is we don't call this state or a persistence now anymore database. We just call it event store. And when we give a request or a command to our business logic, we are retrieving the complete history of our business entity from the event store to rebuild the business entity in the state it was before. And then we change something on this business entity. Every change that we do will emit a new event, which is again stored to the event store. And those changes, those events, the new events will be published for the representation. So in detail, it looks like this. We have a command that triggers a change in the business entity. The business entity was loaded from an event stream, and all the changes, all the new changes will emit new events, will be stored in the event store, and the event store will publish it to all that is interested, to everyone that is interested in. So we don't have a relational database anymore. We don't have any repositories or records or whatever. So how does an event store look like in real life? So this is a simplified example. I will explain the columns now. So this is the event, or all the events that I have taken for my newsletter subscription. The first column, the sequence, is just an increasing number to make you able to order the whole event store, sorting the event store in an ascending order. You can use an auto increment for that. Nowadays, I wouldn't recommend it anymore. Because when you want to split your event store at some point of time, you could get problems with auto increments here. So just use a sequence, that's why the name, and try to increase it by hand. Okay, then we have information about the business entity itself. The stream type is basically what is my business entity. In this case, it's a newsletter subscription. The stream ID identifies my newsletter subscription. So this is a unique ID for especially my my version of the business entity. And the stream sequence is basically how many changes does my business entity has how many events have it. So it's kind of a versioning. So we start at version 1. And every change will rise the version by 1. So this is a sequence that is not the same as the global sequence. And the second sequence is also used to, because when you try to reconstitute your business entity later on based on the event stream, you have to also sort your events of the business entity. So makes sense to have a sequence here too. So then we have the event ID. The event ID is basically the name of the change. So what happened? I prefer to use clear text here. You shouldn't use complete class names or anything else, because if you change the class name afterwards, you might have a problem. So just use clear text, something that you can map onto your class names on the event names. So events are facts that happened in the past. That's why you should use past tense or past perfect, like I do, for your event IDs or event names. Then, of course, we have some payload. The payload is the information, what has changed. And we have a date timestamp here when the event occurs. Important here is, do not rely on those timestamps. Just use them as meta information that you have a clue, okay, that event happened a year ago or 2 weeks ago. Don't use this information to sort your events. Yeah, it could easily break because time zones, time shifts, you name it. Yeah. Use the sequence to sort your events, not the timestamps. Yeah, and in the end, we have some more columns that you can customize. It's just meta information that you could use for your purpose. That should be information that is not relevant to the business. So it's just for you if you want to see, okay, on which server did the event emit, which shop, which country, whatever. Just put it in here if it is not relevant for your business logic. So you can add what you want here. So this part is my first subscription. So as you can see here, the subscription was initialized. My interval was changed. I assigned 3 topics, and I confirmed my subscription. So this is basically what happened over time with my subscription. Please note here that even creating a new subscription is an event. So because I add new state to my application, that's why the first event is always always there. The second part is after I canceled my or I unsubscribed and I resubscribed here. And as you can see, I do not use the same event here as before. So I don't say my subscription was initialized and everything. So I just say my subscription was reactivated. And you will see the second why. And we also have here topic was removed, interval was changed, subscription was confirmed. As you can see, you shouldn't do aggregations when you change multiple things. So I could also have used the topics were changed as an event and say, okay, before I had three topics, now I have one topic. Forget about the rest. Yeah? So no, better is to say, okay, I have removed two topics and one is one state in the state. So and here you can see why this is different between reactivation and initialization. So in the first initialization, I need to create a subscription ID. I have my full name and my email address. And when I reactivate this subscription, I just need the ID. So I don't need any more information. So my tip is do not add previous information to new events. Because they were already recorded before. You have them in your timeline. That is the point where you should stop thinking relational. Yeah? So replacing information in the database, it's just appending things to the database. So everything you already had before is still there, and you can use it, and you can just add new things. So yeah, some interfaces here just to give you an idea how this all looks like. So the event interface, this has the stream ID, an event ID, and the payload. And you can recreate the event from payload. Important here is, for the payload, use a data format that is technology independent. So don't use serialized PHP code, please. Use something like JSON or XML or whatever you think is a good flat file format. Yeah. So it shouldn't change. It doesn't matter what application is reading the event store. It always should work. Yeah. Then we will wrap the event into an event envelope. And this is just to add the meta information for the event store. And we will separate those things from each other. So the header will contain all the meta information, and the event will contain the payload, of course. So the event header interface looks like this. So we have the stream type, the stream ID, stream sequence, when it is secured, and meta, whatever. Yeah. So and this is the thing that we will send to the event store, and the event store will make a record out of it. So some important points about event sourcing. The event store is an immutable and append-only table. Yeah, it's just one table, if you think about it. And you don't change it. You just add new records to it. That's basically it. It's the only source of truth. So all the representation that you have, when you say, OK, I have a new newsletter subscription, and I want to show it in the back end of the shop, for the user, that information could be outdated or it could even be lost on your representation. You can restore it from all your events. That's the main advantage of doing event sourcing. So if you lose your source of truth, you're screwed, of course. As I said, use technology independent payload. Most of the parts of event sourcing are immutable, so events are immutable. Value objects, of course, are immutable, and the event stream is a sorted list of all events that you have for a business entity or for multiple business entities or your whole event store. And important is that your business entity cannot be created without an event stream. So that is what I meant before. When you give birth to an object, that is an event, and you cannot recreate that object without this event. So what you have to do is get the event stream out of the event store and replay it onto your object, so you will have the object in the latest state. So let's have a look at some code, how that looks like. This is my newsletter subscription, my business entity. Of course, I stripped out some code because it doesn't fit on the slide. But the important things are, I have a stream type here, which is just newsletter subscription. I start with my sequence zero. And I have a list of changes, which is an event stream. And when I say, OK, I cannot create a business entity without emitting an event or changing, storing an event, that is this part. I just say, OK, I want to initiate a new subscription. And what I do here is just, OK, internally create an instance of the subscription and call the record that method. And the record that method will record a new event. And I return the subscription. So what does this record that do? The record that creates those event envelopes, adds the stream type, the stream sequence, which are coming from the business entity itself, and will add the event. And then we'll say, OK, this is a new change, so I will add it to my change list. And then I call the apply function. And the apply function is basically the method that you will use later on also to recreate your event. So when you have an event stream will be consist of multiple event envelopes when you get it from the event store. And then you just call for every event envelope the apply function. And the apply function will just say, OK, map my event name to a method and give that method the event. So in this case, it would be when subscription was initialized, the method. And this method is basically your real constructor. So when you say, we didn't set any values at the moment, so in the business entity itself, we just recorded an event and applied this event to the entity itself. And what we are doing now is, this is the apply method here that is called. We're just setting the email and the full name. And that allows us to don't do this when I create the new object, but also can do this when I replay all the events to the object. Those methods will be called, and all the internal properties will be set. Yeah, and that is basically what this method does. This is the reconstitute method. It gets an event stream, will loop over the event stream, and call the apply method to all the events. And as you can see, this is a static method. So if you want to create an existing business entity, you pull the event stream out of the event store, hand it over here, and at the end, you will get your subscription in the latest state. That's basically it. So an abstract business entity could look like this. So this could be a base class that you can extend from. And when we have our business entity, we of course add actions to that, so we can change the state. What we do here is assign a topic to the newsletter subscription. Important is here that when you do event sourcing, you don't have so many objects that are related to each other. If you have objects that are related to each other, you will have an so-called aggregate route, which is handling all the actions from the outside. So my newsletter subscription, if I want to change something in my newsletter subscription, for example, adding a relation to a topic. I won't create a topic and will add it to the newsletter subscription. I will just say, okay, newsletter subscription, assign me a topic, and it will handle the rest in the background. So this is where objects are aggregated to one logical business entity. So yeah, we have a assigned topic here, and as you can see, you always have two methods. So the assigned topic is the method that you call from the outside, and you have the protected method when topic was assigned. So those when methods are always the methods that really do the apply the changes, and the assigned topic in this case would be the method that emits the event and applies the event to the business entity itself. Yeah, and to be not so much confused, you can separate those things with traits. So you can just leave the public API in the object and use a trait for all those internal methods. It is, for organizational parts, very nice. Okay, what questions can we ask now after we have applied event sourcing to our newsletter subscription? So for example, we can ask now, how big was the unsubscribe ratio in 2016? How many users reactivated their subscription in 2017? How many users reactivated more than once? Which topic was removed the most? And yeah, how many users changed the interval before subscription was canceled? So this is information that could be very valuable to your business data analyst to change the newsletter subscription process, or to change the options that you have when you subscribe to newsletters, or change the intervals and everything, so that you can see, you can optimize your business based on way more information. And also the good thing is that you may not have those questions when you started implementing all the stuff, but then the data analyst came and say, hey, I have those questions, and you can say, okay, I can answer them because I have all the information in my event store. That is a very good feeling. So yeah, back to the image here, to our model. So this is the part that I explained at, before. So we create a history from changes, create our business entity, and add new changes. Now let's have a look at the representation part here. In event sourcing, it's not called representation, it's called projection, because we are projecting the current state to some kind of other information. And again, you can do this asynchronously, and it leads to eventual consistency. those projections, there are different kinds of projections that I want to mention shortly. So we have so-called push views. That is basically the approach that we had before. We are sending a message, we have a subscriber, and the subscriber can create a representation or a projection out of this information that he got by the message. So for example, if the message contains our full subscription, he can just say, okay, the subscription looks like this. Then we have pull views. Pull views can accept queries from the outside and can also query the event store to get all the events and information that it needs to represent the current state. So this is more on demand. And we also have, of course, mixed views. That is a good use case when you have a message that does not contain all the information that you need for representation. So if you have only the subscription ID, for example, in your message, but you need the name or the email address as well, you would just again query the event store, get the relevant events out of it for the subscription ID, and create your representation. So you can mix and match those things as you want. So the important part of the projection is, like I said before, you should use a data format that is optimized for your read-only use case. and it should be the most simple data information that you have. And it could also be useful that your projection is another event store. For example, if you have a calendar application or something like that, and you have millions of calendar events, it could make sense to have a separate event store for each calendar type or each all events that happened in the past. So you can just add or slice your event store to another event store. And the good thing is you still have all the events in the main event store, but you can do faster queries on the second event store for representation. So yeah, use case dependent. Okay, let's sum up the advantages of CQRS. What can we gain? So we have separate input and output handling because we separated it. We have the opportunity to optimize each site for its operational purpose. That means if you have a write-intensive application, you should optimize the write site. If you have a read-intensive application, like most web applications are, you should optimize the read side. Yeah, like I said, it depends on your application and your domain, of course. You get cleaner code by design because you heavily avoid side effects. You don't have controllers that do post and get requests in the same time. It's everything is divided, and you just know, okay, when I want to change something in my post site, I go there. And you should also make the separation visible in your code base. So have different folders for read and write. Makes it really, really easy to follow this along. Yeah, no unintended side effects. You are more technology independent for each site. So if you need a fast read site, you are able to replace the data storage, for example. When you have all those events in place, you can simply replay events to a new technology and replace the new technology with the old one. The other way around, of course. And it's also easier to scale one of those sites. So if you have a write site that needs to be absolutely consistent, it's okay if that site is a bit slower. And if you have a really read-intense application with a lot of traffic, you can easily scale the read site by adding servers that are only used for the read site. We don't do any servers anymore, right? It's all serverless today. Okay, what can we gain from event sourcing? It's basically, we also have a high scalability because we only have one large database or one large database table in the end. And the question that I always get is, but that gets really slow, No, it doesn't. So you have to imagine it's one database, it's append only. You are having integer indexes for sorting. And even if you have 500 million rows in that record, it's not slow. I can promise you. And if it gets slow, if you are Uber or Facebook or whatever, then there are also options by using snapshots and a lot of advanced stuff to come along with those problems. Yeah, like I said, it's a simplification of the storage. So you have one storage for all information. It's one size fits all. And that is really neat. So because you don't ever, ever again need to care about data modeling. It's just one table, that's it. You can trace all the changes that you made in your application. You can later on analyze those data, even for questions that you didn't have before. You can adapt new business requirements with these, just adding new processes after the events or adding new events is really easy. And it's always the same thing. So you always just, in the end, it's really boring because you just say, okay, a new event, a new handler, a new event, a new handler. It's very when you have done, when you are so far, it's really boring. So restoring the application to any given point in time, that is also a thing that we often need, for, especially for applications that have financial information, that you need to say, okay, I need this application in the state of the last day in December in 2018. And we have May 2019. So how do we do that? So we want, we just replay or clone the application, replay all the events until December 31st, and that's it. So now we have the representation also of this moment in time. Yeah, if you do bugs, who's doing bugs? Nobody, I know. Yeah, just if you have a bug in your application, the good thing is you can fix the bug, replay the events, and your representation is, or your views are consistent again. So who have seen GitHub going down last week or the week before? Yeah, it was the that kind of problem. So they had all their events in place, but the front-end database had an error, and they just replayed all the events until the view was consistent again. Took them one day, I think. But yeah, was a good example how that works. And of course, we have only one database table. It's easy to backup and restore. That's also a big advantage of that approach. Questions? Yeah. Ah. No, I think the cube is broken. Ah, no. But just ask the question.
Your older entries won't have this field, but the new one will have. You will create another class that represents the subscription with this date of birth?
Yeah. In that case, of course, you don't have the information for the old subscriptions. So you have to need it. So either you can do it an optional information for the event, or you create a completely new event. So that would be the, I think, the best approach. Just user event, user subscription with birth date. Okay.
And second one, for example, if you receive a GDPR request from a customer that he wants his information deleted, you just go through your old events and delete that.
Yeah, email. So what you can do is to, so that the events will stay intact, is just to erase the information or replace it with dummy data. That is okay if you do so. There are also approaches that are way more complicated. So you are encrypting all the information in the events, and you have a separate store with all the keys for the encryption, and you just delete the key for, so you cannot decrypt it anymore. There's also with more technical depth, of course, a good approach. I think you always have to consider that deleting is not deleting. In most cases, deleting, so in Germany, for example, it means nobody can have access to it. So if you store it in your event store and everybody has only access to the representation of that event store, you can just remove it from the representation and basically you're fine. So. Yep.
And how do you handle lists in these cases? When, for example, manager wants a list of all subscribers and he wants to order everything, so you're creating some kind of presentation layer that pulls out from all the events?
Yeah. So for example, in this case, my representation would be, for example, one database table with all the subscribers, mm-hmm. so you can easily query that table. Mm-hmm. A second representation could be an HTML list, whatever. So it's not a problem.
Yeah, okay. Thank you.
Yeah, over there.
Where?
I think we have 2 minutes.
Thank you.
2 minutes? No? Okay.
At the start,
last question.
At the start, you said that the command side of the application can't return anything. So I see some problems with that. For one, when you create the subscription, you created new ID for the subscription, but you need to somehow return this ID to the user so that he can then select information about it later.
Yeah.
So how would you do that? And second problem is that you only validate the user input in the middleware, but if there is some issue later that you can only validate with the previous state or something, then you can't return this error. So how do you notify the user that
of course,
this?
Of course, I left a lot of code out here, but in the end, it's you do validation in your business logic that was the command handler. So you would raise exceptions there and catch the exceptions and return the result with the with appropriate error message or information. The first one is that you create UUIDs for the subscription, so you won't get any clashes. And of course, you can provide those information back to the user. So it's the question how you will do it. So I need to stop. Yeah. Thank you very much.